Hi and welcome to this Ignite webcast. My name is Josh Chopal and I'm a program manager for Office 365. And Ignite events are a series of technical workshops for IT professionals and Microsoft partners. So these Ignite webcasts will address different technical subjects and scenarios that are really beneficial to anyone that wants to increase their knowledge of the Office 365 suite. So today we're really excited to have back Roop Sankar leading our webcast. Roop is a premier field engineer for Microsoft in the UK and has close to 8 years of experience. In today's webcast, Roop will talk to us about how easy it is to set up, manage, configure, and administer site mailboxes in your Exchange 2013 environment. So today's session provides a really great opportunity for you to get some time from someone with such knowledge of Office 365. And today's webcast will be about an hour, and we'll leave a few minutes at the end to field questions from anyone on the call. So you can type your questions into the link chat box during the presentation, but again, I ask that you hold those questions till the end for the Q&A portion. One last thing is that we are recording today's session, and we'll have the recording and the slideshow up on the original blog post, which I'm gonna go ahead and paste here. So that's it for me. So Roop, whenever you're ready, we can get started.
Thank you, Josh. Okay, so just like last time, I see people from different parts of the world. So good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to each one of you. And today's session, we'll be covering site mailboxes in Exchange 2013. And again, just highlighting the fact this applies to Office 365 as well. This is not only about on-prem, so this applies both to Office 365. That is, if you have a tenant in Office 365, or else if you are planning to implement Exchange 2013, or if you already have Exchange 2013 on-prem. Today's session objectives is we'll first of all obviously try and understand what a site mailbox is. So is it a site? Is it a SharePoint site? Is it a mailbox? Or is it a hybrid of both? We'll try and understand, when would you use a site mailbox? What are the use cases when it would be appropriate to use a site mailbox? And obviously understanding its workings. It's important to understand because these are two different things. We've got some SharePoint in the mix, then we've got Exchange in the mix, who talks to whom and what information is sent between each other. And the key takeaways would be, just trying to understand overall what a site mailbox is and trying to understand how to manage these site mailboxes, because it's slightly different from the norm for an Exchange admin's perspective. So it's important to understand, how would you manage a site mailbox. And then lastly, I've just put there, it's not a takeaway, but if you really want to play with site mailboxes and, without a lot of work involved, then, just go for your Office 365 tenant or just create a trial tenant. And then everything in the back end that needs to be done, there is some prerequisites that have to be done actually, that has all been done in Office 365. The only thing that you'll have to do is just go ahead and, just enable a site mailbox for a SharePoint site, for example. So all the burden and all the prerequisites and all the patches and setup of authentication, etc., has all been taken place. And once you go to Office 365, if you already have a test tenant or if you're a customer with Office 365, you can just go right now after the session and just create a site mailbox. You don't have to do anything additional. You don't have to request access or anything of that sort. It's already turned on for you to make use of. So a site mailbox, at its very crux, it is used for sharing and collaboration. So it's one of those sharing and collaboration methodologies that we have. And in Exchange, we already had a few. It's not that Exchange never had anything of that sort. And this slide kind of highlights that. So let's start from the extreme right, which is the most easiest to talk about. It's the distribution list. So distribution list is, just send an email to a distribution list and then that particular email is again sent across to the members of the distribution list. Nothing very fancy there. A public folder, you can think of a public folder as a library for your organization, and a public folder can hold any type of item. It can hold emails, it can hold calendars, it can hold tasks, it can hold posts. So it literally is a library for the organization. And the public folder has its own tree, for example, and you can expand the tree, go into your, into your branch, and then ultimately dig into that particular folder that you're interested in, and then fetch out the data that you're looking for. So all in all, a public folder is this big library for your organization where you can dump and keep all this data. And the next one is your shared mailbox. So shared mailbox can be thought of as some kind of a virtual entity. So, you know, we all manage the shared mailbox in some time or the other. So a shared mailbox, we've got three or four users looking at a shared mailbox, and somebody sends an email to the shared mailbox. So that, let's say in this example, we've got sales@contoso.com, and a response is sent back for that query. And when the response goes back, it goes back as sales@contoso.com. So it doesn't go back as, for example, roop@contoso.com, you know, if I were to manage this shared mailbox. So a shared mailbox is primarily working on behalf of a virtual entity. And lastly, when we talk about this new feature of a site mailbox, the site mailbox is primarily used or utilized in project kind of scenarios. So let us say if you have a group of users or a group of your company users who are working against a shared outcome or a shared deliverable, so they have a common agenda and they're all working against this common purpose, then for those type of users who are working in SharePoint, they have got the SharePoint library, they're creating these documents and, you know, working on it, and then obviously they're sending emails between each other. For these type of users or for these type of scenarios, a site mailbox would be very ideal. Okay, and just to put this all into perspective, you know, I've just talked about site mailbox, but you know, it's always better to see it in action and then kind of build upon it. And so that's the very reason why I've got a demo right at the start. So for those who have never seen a site mailbox or who are a little bit confused as to, you know, what exactly is a site mailbox, I'll first show you the end user's experience, and also kind of throw in a few use cases to make it a little more clearer rather than just showing you, okay, this is a site mailbox. I'll just try to create some scenarios, and hopefully that will kind of make it more clearer as to when you would effectively use a site mailbox. Okay, so I'll just jump over to my second primary monitor. That's where my... Outlook is... And hopefully you can all see it in a second. Okay, so hopefully you can all see it. So this is my Outlook. And on the left-hand side, you can see like approximately five containers. So the first one, nothing new. You all know it. It's the inbox, or rather my mailbox. So I've got my inbox, I've got my junk mail, outbox, etc., etc. However, below that, I've got four other containers, you know. And these are nothing but your site mailboxes. And these site mailboxes are automatically lit up within Outlook as long as you're a member of that SharePoint site. And when I say automatically, it is not really automatically. It's done using auto-discover, okay, to be more technical over here. So in the real world, so just to show you how exactly it's being retrieved, and if I click on... I'll just put in the password, and I'll just do an auto-discover query, and hopefully you should be able to see it. And on the left-hand side are all the site mailboxes, and the information comes in via auto-discover. So if I just scroll to the very bottom, and hopefully if I can just zoom in for those who have got a slightly smaller screen. So here, within auto-discover, there is a... within the XML blob, there is a section called alternative mailbox, and within that alternative mailbox, there is a mailbox of the type team mailbox. And within that, you can see each and every site mailbox that I am having access to. So you can see that is my domestic sales, and I've got technology integration, and lastly, I've got another one which is called ZT1000 launch. So these are my four site mailboxes that I have access to, and they are automatically come up or show up within my Outlook. I don't have to, as an end user, go ahead and add this, you know, specifically or implicitly into my Outlook as such. As long as I'm a member of that particular SharePoint site, which is associated with the site mailbox, they would all light up within my Outlook client. So let us just open up one of them, and I'll use this for the demo purposes. So first thing that you can do is, the first and the most easiest thing that you can do is just to look at the SharePoint site. So if I just right click on my documents, and if I click on open in web browser, you can see the actual SharePoint site that particular site mailbox is associated with. So if I click on documents, you can see all the documents that are there within that site mailbox. So if I just click back within documents, you can see all the documents over there. And if I go back again to that SharePoint site, you can see subfolders called version 2.2, version 1. They are automatically all highlighted over here. So as subfolders within documents, you can see version 2.2 and version 1. And you can see all the documents and the read and unread count. So, and one more thing to note is, what you're seeing here within the documents folder, it is not the actual documents per se. Okay, so just to again reiterate, it is not synchronizing the whole document. What you're seeing here is, Exchange is only synchronizing the metadata. And within the metadata, all that it is synchronizing is, it is synchronizing the file name, it is synchronizing the file type, the file extension, you know, the last changed by date and time, who was it changed by, the size, et cetera, et cetera. So, for example, if I just actually just open up this Litware contract.doc file, and you can see it is actually just trying to go and connect to something. And once it opens up, it is not going ahead and opening some local file which is there on my desktop. It is actually going to that particular SharePoint site and opening it. And just to prove that, you know, it's not a local cache, if I probably click on file, and here you can actually see where it is opening it from. So it's opening it directly from the SharePoint site. So it is not a local file that I have on my desktop or on my laptop. Neither through the cache, it is just going all the way across to the SharePoint site and pulling it. So what you're actually seeing within Outlook is only the metadata, you know, just to make it look nice. That is all. But the actual file is residing within the SharePoint site. And this is how we prevent, duplication. And let us take a scenario for that matter. You know, let me just go back to my inbox. And I have been working with Bob on a project of product design. So I'm creating some products and I'm designing these products. And I've been working with Bob. And Bob recently just sent me an email which contains here. Okay, so he sent me some performance, modeling for that particular product, and he sent me all this performance data, and he's asked me to review. This is how we would do traditionally, you know. We would send this document, I would review it, I would put my comments within it, and I would send it back to Bob. Bob would again modify it, again send it back to me. So we've got these, you know, a whole, different versions of that same document. And then ultimately we are not sure whether all these changes have been incorporated into the final document. However, if you think of SharePoint, SharePoint already has this inbuilt. You know, it was built as a document system. So we've got versioning within it, we've got co-authoring within it, we've got check-in, check-out, we've got all these fancy abilities within SharePoint. So why not use SharePoint for all that, rather than having to use this method wherein, you know, Bob is sending me this document, he's asking me for review. So I've told Bob many a times, you know, that don't do this, you know, use SharePoint and do that. But SharePoint is very, tricky at sometimes, because I have to remember the SharePoint link, and if I've, you know, somebody has sent me that link, I have to go and fetch for that link, then click on that particular link, then go into SharePoint. So I've got two disparate systems. You know, I've got Outlook to work in, and then I've got SharePoint. So ultimately what happens, the end user would just use Outlook. Best is he would just attach this attachment and then send it across. So let's actually now see how we can actually change the end users working so that he can use site mailboxes effectively. So first thing is, we have to stop sending documents in an email, and we have to put it back into SharePoint. So within this email, you can see this document that's attached. I'm just going to drag it, and I'm just going to drop it within this documents folder, which is associated to the documents library within that particular SharePoint site. And over here, you can see now it is slightly italicized and in gray. So what is happening is Outlook now tells Exchange, okay, here's the document. Exchange looks at it and says, okay, it's a document type. I'm not a document repository. And then it says, okay, I know that there is a SharePoint site that's associated with the site mailbox. So then it goes and talks all the way to the SharePoint site and says, okay, here's the document, and I want you to consume it. And then SharePoint looks at it, checks all the membership. Okay, fine, I accept that Alice can, you know, upload this document, and it uploads it. So as you can see here, from one point, from within Outlook, I was able to upload a document, and this document is currently now sitting within SharePoint. So if we just quickly jump over, and probably if I just refresh the documents folder, you should see the file come up within the document. So I'll just give it another second or so. So while we're just waiting for it to reflect, so here is the document that is already there, that has come up, and I can see the document. And if I now double click on this document, and we'll just wait for it to connect, And again, just to see whether it's actually connecting to the SharePoint site, I'll just again zoom in. And you can see it is not opening up any local drive. It's connecting to the Microsoft Teams site, you know, which is a site, the SharePoint site, where the actual file has been uploaded. Okay, so it makes it very easy now, you know, to work with SharePoint sites, etc. And let's now take the case where we are teaching Bob on how to effectively use site mailboxes. So let me first go ahead and right-click on this document. And if I click on forward, you can see right away there is a hyperlink that's added to the body of the email. So I can just go ahead and type Bob's name over there, and then I can just tell him, you know, this is how you need to do it, how you do it. And from now on, he wouldn't realize that, you know, he can use this easy method of actually sharing documents and keeping them at one point. And there's an alternate method of doing it. You can actually, you know, just close that, go back to your email, and I'll just go ahead and reply Bob. So I'll just do a reply, and I'll just pop this out. I'll go back to my documents repository. I'll choose this or select this particular document, which, you know, he had sent me earlier. I'll copy, I'll take that, I'll go to my mailbox, go to my particular email, and I'll just paste it over there. That's it. Okay. So that's it. So I've put the, you know, I didn't have to send the whole attachment. I have sent him a reference to the attachment, which ultimately is within SharePoint. So now we all who are part of this product design, you know, project, we all are working against one document rather than everybody sending his or her own version of a document. And we are having these multiple copies right now. Everybody is being pointed to this one central document, and all changes and all edits, all deletions, all adds are happening against this one document. So the collaboration story is wonderful now, rather than, as I mentioned in the earlier example, where we've got these multiple copies. So we did this for one document. Can we do it for multiple documents? Yes, we can. So you can just select, you know, let's say you want to select these five or six documents. I go back into Outlook, go back to that particular email, and then I just drop it wherever I want. So right now within that email, I have put hyperlinks automatically without having to go into SharePoint, you know, choose the hyperlink and come back. And for the Exchange admin, this is very, it's a great relief, because he has always been telling everyone that, you know, use SharePoint, you know, but don't send these large attachments or these large 8, 10 MB, you know, PowerPoint files. Now, because of this ability for the SharePoint to be represented within Outlook as a site mailbox, and for the end user to use or consume the document directly from Outlook, you know, he doesn't have to send these large attachments. So again, from the Exchange perspective, you're not sending these very large attachments. And now Exchange, within Exchange, you don't have a duplication of data, because now you only have one single point, that is SharePoint, where all documents are residing. Whereas earlier, you had the document in SharePoint, you had the document within an attachment, within an email, and you've got all this additional data that's just flowing within the organization. Right now, the collaboration story gets, you know, much more smoother, and it's much more appropriate, and it increases the productivity of the end user. So that is how one of the use cases where the site mailboxes are very effective in this case. Okay, one more thing, a customer asked me a question, so it just came to mind, is with regards to searching, you know, because it's almost like, you know, it's all already within Outlook, so can I search? So just like how you can search, or if you have a mailbox, how you can search only against your mailbox, similarly, within Outlook, you can only search within that site mailbox. Though I have four site mailboxes that I own or that I'm a member of, I cannot search across site mailboxes. So I can only search, if I want to do a search, I can only search within product design. If I want to search, I can only search within domestic sales. If I do a search, I can only search within technology integration, and similarly in ZT1000 launch. So I cannot do search across site mailboxes. It is contained to a particular site mailbox. Okay. Even the site mailbox has an inbox as well. Okay. So it is not only a representation of the SharePoint site. It also has an inbox. You can also send an email. And whenever you are a member of a SharePoint site which also has a site mailbox, you would automatically get a mail something similar. And in the future, you can actually go ahead and, you know, just send emails directly to the site mailbox. You don't have to send it to the user. Like, for example, Bob doesn't have to send it to Alice, and Alice doesn't have to, again, then move that email. So you can actually directly email it to this particular site mailbox. Okay. And just looking at my list of things that I have to, you know, talk about so that I don't miss about on the use case scenarios. A few more things that you can also do is just to see a list of all the site mailboxes I'm a member of, you can actually go ahead and right-click on the root and select Manage All Site Mailboxes. And just before I click on that, here you can see in my Outlook, you can see four site mailboxes lit up. And there is a limit as to how many site mailboxes are visible within Outlook. There is a maximum of 10. So you can only see 10 site mailboxes within Outlook. Now you might question me, if I'm a member, you know, I'm working on multiple projects and I've got more than 10 site mailboxes I'm a member of, not a problem. What I'm saying is you can only pin and unpin 10 site mailboxes. And just to make it clear, let's go ahead and click on Manage Site Mailboxes. And once this opens up, so here you can see I'm actually a member of 5 different site mailboxes. However, I have controlled what I would like to see within my Outlook. So here within this console, here on the top you can see Show in Outlook. So by toggling this checkbox, you can control what you would like to see within Outlook. So let us say in the example that I spoke about, where you are a member of more than 10 site mailboxes, you can, you know, uncheck the ones that are not active, the projects that you're not working currently on. Uncheck those and bring those ones or select the checkbox against those that you're working on currently or that you're working on actively. So that is how you control what the number of site mailboxes or the site mailboxes that you're interested in or the site mailboxes that you're actively working on. And additional information that you can see here is once you open up, you can actually see the status of the site mailbox. So in my case, you can see all the site mailboxes are active and you can see the role that I have on this particular site mailbox. I am a member of the site mailbox. I'm not an owner. So the owner is, you know, the tenant admin, which is Roop. So right now I've logged in as Alice. So and Alice is a member of the site mailbox. So here is how you control what you can see within Outlook, within the Outlook client. Okay, let's go back. One more thing is if I just go back to the site itself. One very important thing to note, if I expand my domestic sales, and if you just very closely observe domestic sales site mailbox with the product design site mailbox, there is something missing within the domestic sales site mailbox. So what we are missing is, you will see the documents is missing. You know, here I see documents under product design, but I don't see documents within domestic sales. The reason for that is, there is a criteria for what Exchange can show you with regards to documents. So let me just jump back to this particular site, which is called Domestic Sales. So under Domestic Sales, if I go under Site Contents, I do have a document library. And if I click on the document library, I do have a document sitting within it. However, this document library is not pinned within Quick Launch. So this area of the SharePoint site is called the Quick Launch. So if this document library is not pinned to Quick Launch, Exchange will not show it within Outlook. Okay. So the criteria for Outlook to show any document library is it first has to be a document library, and secondly, it has to be pinned to the Quick Launch. So this is what because you see here there is no documents that I can directly click over here, and that's the reason why within Outlook I don't see it. And this is another way for the end user to control. You know, if the end user doesn't want a few document libraries showing up within Outlook, he can actually unpin it within SharePoint, that is, not put it into Quick Launch, and then it would not be visible within Outlook for the, you know, for the team members if they're working within Outlook directly. Okay. And just because it is an Outlook, you can control what you can do with the folders. So, for example, I can actually go ahead and add this to my favorites. And once you add it to favorites, you can see it comes up over here. One good thing that I like about the site mailbox is this red unread status. So, for example, I'm working with a colleague, And traditionally, if you just go back, if you remove site mailboxes from your mind for now, until and unless someone tells me that I have put a document within SharePoint, I wouldn't know about it. So I would have to, you know, somebody has to send an email saying that, okay, a document has been put into SharePoint, then I go to SharePoint, and then I just kind of look at it. You know, there are other ways of doing it, but I have to be notified per se. However, in because Outlook now shows you the site mailbox with all the unread and read status. For example, if I go ahead and let's say I've already read all these documents, Bob goes ahead and uploads a new document within this version 1 subfolder, for example, it would come up and it would change the counter to 1. So I can quickly, you know, without even having to go to the SharePoint, said I know that, okay, some update has happened within the version 1 folder. I can go to the version 1, you know, directly from here. I don't even have to go to the SharePoint site. Let's say this was a new document that was posted. I can double-click on this document, make the changes, edit, delete, whatever, and then ultimately save it. So these are some of the advantages where we have brought SharePoint within to Exchange. But again, just mentioning, we are not syncing the whole content to Exchange. So Exchange is not actually, you know, making copies of that within its database or anything of that sort. It's only synchronizing the metadata. Okay. And okay, so that's about it, and that I had within the demo. So this is how the end user. The end user's experiences and the different use cases that I showed you on how he would use the document library. So let's go back to our slide deck and just continue where we left off. I'll start my session. So just let me know once it comes up. So just to put all this into perspective, and let's just look at how site mailboxes work at a very high level. So for the end user, so IW stands for information worker. So for the end user, he's just using his Outlook. He can use the SharePoint site, but, you know, because now we have integrated SharePoint directly within Outlook in the form of a site mailbox, he can directly work within that site mailbox. He can edit it, he can delete it, he can add content to the document, and all the users are working against the single document rather than having this duplication of data and having different versions of that data. You're all working against one single document. So the collaboration story is more, very great, and it's very super easy for the end user. And just to look at it at the back end, and just to reinforce what we have been talking, the site mailbox has, you know, two links. So it has got a little bit in Exchange and a little bit in SharePoint. So the inbox section that we saw within the site mailbox, it holds everything within Exchange itself, within the Exchange mailbox or within the database. And everything that you saw with regards to the documents was all within the SharePoint itself. All that was synchronized between Exchange and the SharePoint is the metadata, you know, just for viewing purposes. It was just cosmetic, you know, so it's easy for the end user to see, okay, it's a PowerPoint document, it's a Word document, what's the name of the Word document, et cetera, et cetera. And every control that is access to a site mailbox is all done through the SharePoint site. So membership to a site mailbox, whether I can see a site mailbox, whether I can perform some activity within a site mailbox, is all controlled through the SharePoint site. So this is slightly different from what Exchange admins have been doing, because, you know, mailboxes, you just open the Exchange admin console, you add permissions, send as, receive as, you know, you do all this activity within the mailbox within the Exchange admin console. But this is slightly different and special. The site mailbox is all controlled via the SharePoint site that it is associated with. So the membership, as in the owners or the members that you want to add to a site mailbox, has to be done via the SharePoint site itself. And lastly, because it's an entity, it is like a site mailbox, it too has like a life cycle. So all the provisioning and management of the site mailbox, again, has to be done or can only be done via the associated SharePoint site. It cannot be done through the you cannot do it directly through the mailbox or anything of that sort. So creation, deletion, everything of the, anything that is to do with the life cycle of the site mailbox has to be done from the SharePoint site itself. So let us just look at the background workings of how how the site mailbox works when a user clicks on a particular document. We've talked about this many times, but I'll just kind of reinforce it again. So let us say the end user double clicks on a document within his Outlook client. All that is happening is Outlook is providing the URL, and that URL actually points to the PowerPoint. In this example, points to the PowerPoint that is hosted or that is held within the SharePoint site itself. So Outlook just gives back the link to the application, which is PowerPoint. And then PowerPoint first looks at any offline cache that it might have, or it might look at any offline, you can create websites which are offline as well, which is an offline state. So it will look whether it has any offline copy of that particular document. If it doesn't have an offline copy of the document, it will go ahead, directly connect to the SharePoint site, and then it would render that document. So, you know, as we've spoken many a times, nothing is kept within Exchange. Everything that is with regards to the document is held within the SharePoint site, and anything within the inbox, within the site mailbox, is held within the mailbox, which is on the Exchange server. So let us see how easy it is to create and provision a site mailbox. So the task is very simple; it's just straightforward. So specifically for Exchange admins, because most of Exchange admins aren't SharePoint admins, so I just wanted to show you how easy it is from an end user's perspective to create a site mailbox. Even the admin doesn't have to be involved, as long as the SharePoint admin has given a user the ability to create sites, you can go ahead with it. So just give me a second; I'll just flip over to my primary screen and. Okay, so I'll go back and I'll just open any website for that matter. I'll just go back to, let us see this one. And, okay, so I've got this website, this is just a website that I just created. It's called, Bombay Talkies, and brand new, nothing has been done, just out of the box. I just created this website, and you can see there's nothing there on the screen. And by default in Exchange, in SharePoint 2013, when you create a new site, right here on the extreme right, you can see there is something that we've just put, so that the user can start consuming a site mailbox or start provisioning a site mailbox. So if I go ahead and click this option, and it's very self-explanatory, keeping email in context. So when I click on this, what happens in the background is SharePoint calls an app. It's an application, so it is called a site mailbox app for SharePoint. So SharePoint doesn't understand mailboxes or anything of that sort. So it just sees, okay, it's a site mailbox app. And so if you look at the very top, it's called adding. You're actually adding an application. And when I click on add it, it's going to add the site mailbox to this site of mine, which I just created. And on the extreme left, if you look very closely, there is a new folder which is called mailbox. So though you see the folder called mailbox, there is no site mailbox created yet. So if you actually have to go ahead and create a site mailbox, you have to go ahead, or the end user has to go ahead and click on the mailbox container. And once you create this, now SharePoint goes and talks to Exchange, and it tells Exchange that I have this site, the SharePoint site, and I need to provision a mailbox of the type site mailbox for this particular SharePoint site. And now Exchange goes ahead, checks permissions, et cetera, and then goes ahead, and in the background, it is now creating this new site mailbox. So until and unless you click on that particular container called mailbox, the actual site mailbox is not being provisioned in the back end. So as you can see, the site mailbox has been created, and if you just want to go back to the SharePoint site, I'll just click on the SharePoint site, and this time if I click on mailbox, if everything has happened quick enough in the back end, you should see that it would, just go ahead and you would connect to Outlook Web App. And that's what you would see. Just, it's exactly Outlook Web Access, but slightly different in the sense that, it's actually a site mailbox. And you can see this invitation mail that comes up, and it says that in the future, if you ever want to, send emails directly to the site mailbox, use this particular email, and you can click on this other hyperlink that kind of teaches the end user how he needs to use this. And if you want to now flip back to the SharePoint site, you can actually go ahead and click on, and then you can come back to the site. Now you can start going ahead uploading documents. You don't have to upload documents from here because now I've created a site mailbox. I can actually go ahead and just assign members, and assigning members is very easy. In SharePoint 2013, right on the top, you have a button called as Share. So once you click on this Share option, you'll get a small pop-up. And over here, let us say, just add Alice. Alice over here. And you can see options if you want. By default, it'll add them as members. So as long as you're a member or an owner of a SharePoint site, you would get access to that site mailbox. So once I click on Share, an email is sent across, and then I should, I can start using this new SharePoint site. So I don't have to see this SharePoint ever in my life again, until unless for some special scenarios. But because I have now been added as a member of this particular site, I can now start working with it in Outlook, and I would see this within Outlook after 1 hour in the default auto discover period. You know, by default it runs every 1 hour. Else, if I want to, you know, get this done very quickly, I can close and open Outlook, and then I should be able to see the new site mailbox, you know, come up at the bottom over here. So as you saw, it's so easy to go ahead and provision. And this has, I did it as an end user. I don't have to be an admin, or, you know, you don't have to tell the admin, can you please do it? You can do that, but, you know, sites are something that is end users. So the end users can go ahead and add all these functionalities and capabilities within their site to, you know, increase their collaboration capabilities. Okay, so just jumping back to our demo, and I'll just bring up back that slide. So you saw how easy it was to go ahead and create and provision a site mailbox. Within two clicks, you have a site mailbox ready, and you are able to already start using it. And you know, in a short duration of time, you would also see it within Outlook, and then you would never have to go back to the SharePoint site again. You would never have to remember that long SharePoint URL, nothing of that sort. Just you are ready to go at the get-go. So out of the box, it's very easy within SharePoint. And however, if you're in an organization which kind of centralizes SharePoint sites, you know, you create the SharePoint form, etc., you can still go ahead and create a central SharePoint form with lots of SharePoint sites, and you can use PowerShell to kind of provision site mailboxes. So there is an ability. It doesn't mean that you have to do via the GUI. You can still go ahead and you can use PowerShell and then in bulk provision site mailboxes for a bunch of SharePoint sites. And the deletion process, it all ties in with the SharePoint site itself. So as I mentioned earlier, during the lifecycle piece is, if you want to delete a site mailbox, you have to delete the associated SharePoint site. And the deletion of a site, SharePoint site, can be manual or it can be policy driven. So irrespective whether it's deleted manually, that is whether the SharePoint site is deleted manually, or it is deleted by a policy, the associated site mailbox would also be deleted. And when I say deleted, it is actually marked for deletion. So keep that in mind, it is marked for deletion. So if in Office 365, there is a background process that runs which kind of searches for all these marked for deletion mailboxes and deletes it. However, if you are implementing this site mailboxes on-prem, the Exchange admin has to perform an additional task wherein he has to search for these marked for deletion mailboxes and then go ahead and delete it. And when I say marked for deletion, all these mailboxes, these site mailboxes which have their original SharePoint sites deleted, they would get a prefix called MDEL, and then all that the Exchange admin has to do is just search for all these mailboxes and then delete it. So as I highlighted earlier or mentioned earlier, in the service, that is Office 365, it's done automatically. However, if it is on-prem, it's an additional task for the Exchange admin. And just to put all the whole life cycle into one picture, we talked about the creation, which is very straightforward. Then we talked about some active usage in the form of some use case scenarios, and we talked about deletion. There is, however, one more state or one more lifecycle state for the site mailbox, which is called the closure. And that is very, that is nothing but your in-place archive. So let us say I've finished working on a project, or a group of members have finished working on a project, and we are done with it. So what you can do is you can actually go ahead and put that particular SharePoint site in a closure state. So by putting it in a closure state, you're not deleting any content within that SharePoint site. It is similar to, you know, your compliance, like how you put, you don't delete a mailbox, or you don't delete a mailbox for, let's say, a year or something of that sort, or items are retained, something like that, you know, just similar to your Exchange. It's exactly the same. So this particular site, when you put the site in on closure state, everything is in an in-place archive state, and everything can be retrieved at a later point in time. And after the closure, once you think it's been a year and I don't need to reference this data again, you can put it into deletion, and at the deletion state, the SharePoint site is deleted and its associated site mailbox is also deleted. So this is a very simple life cycle that is there for a site mailbox. It is different from the your traditional mailbox because it is all governed and controlled using your SharePoint site. Now, looking at some additional functionalities, you know, some few nitty-gritties of a particular site mailbox. So the first thing is you can restore the site connection. So let us say an end user, you know, changed the URL of his SharePoint site, let's say for cosmetic reasons. You can actually go ahead and point the site mailbox to this new URL. So it is an administrative action. The end user cannot do it. So the admin has to go ahead and repoint the site mailbox to this new URL. This can be easily achieved using PowerShell. It is the Exchange PowerShell. The access, so by default, access to a site mailbox is controlled by the members and owners group. So if I am a member, or I'm a member or the owner of that particular SharePoint group, SharePoint site, and that particular SharePoint site also has a site mailbox, then by default, I would see the site mailbox come up or show up within my Outlook client. However, there are still another ways of achieving it. If I have a minimum of read and write access to the particular site, I can still access the site mailbox, but I can only do it via the site mailbox app, which is within SharePoint. So I would not see it within Outlook. If I give read-write access only, I can still access the site, and I can still access the site mailbox only via the SharePoint site mailbox app. Okay. If you want to see it lit up within Outlook, and you want to see Exchange showing it within your Outlook client, then you have to give the full members or an owner group. So that particular end user has to be a member or an owner of that particular SharePoint site. Next is with hybrid scenarios. So something to be very critical and something that has to be kept in mind is the SharePoint site and its associated site mailbox has to be in one location. However, the user's mailbox can be anywhere. So let me just break it down a little more easier. So let us talk about on-prem. Let's think about a hybrid scenario where I have users in the cloud and I have got users on-prem. Now let's talk about site mailboxes. So I've got a SharePoint site which is on-prem. I create a site mailbox for this SharePoint site. That site mailbox has to be on-prem as well. However, the user mailboxes, the normal user mailboxes, can be either on-prem or it can be even in Office 365. Similarly, if I have a SharePoint site which is in Office 365, its site mailbox has to be in Office 365. However, the user mailboxes can be either on-prem or it can be in Office 365. So the boundary for both the SharePoint site and its associated site mailbox has to be, you know, is one. So either both have to be on-prem or either both have to be in the cloud, which is the Office 365 or the service. And lastly, every time you create a site mailbox, and I've got another slide that talks about this in a little bit detail. Whenever you create a site mailbox by default in the service, it is prefixed. It has got a prefix, and the default prefix is SMO. Okay, it's called site mailbox online. However, if your organization doesn't like that prefix, you know, SMO doesn't make sense or you don't like it, you can go ahead and change that prefix. And there's another slide that talks about that in a little more detail. So up to now, I've talked about all the life cycle and the whole, you know, the life cycle of the site mailbox itself is controlled using the SharePoint site. And for Exchange admins, because you've not really played with SharePoint sites much, it is important to understand where exactly is this control. So I'll just show you, it's very easy, very straightforward, where exactly it is within SharePoint and how you can control or create these lifecycle policies which ultimately govern the lifecycle of the site mailbox itself. Okay. So let me again just flip back to my to my primary mailbox. And yeah, I see questions coming up, and those questions would be answered in a few slides. I see something to do with the client, but it'll be answered in a second. Okay, so hopefully you can see my primary screen, and I'll just jump back to a client. And over here, I have opened up the Office 365 as a tenant admin. So as you can see here, I'm an admin right now. And I go into the SharePoint category, so because I want to manage SharePoint, because site mailboxes are controlled and managed using SharePoint. So I click on SharePoint, and over here I have my site collections. So site collections are, you know, whenever I create sites, they are created within site collections. And here is my default site collection. So this is the site collection that you can see over here. So this is my site collection. Every time I create a new site, it is created under this this root. So I need to control this particular route. So for that, what I'll do is I'll go to the properties of the site collection. So I'll go ahead and open it in a new link. And over here, I'm not interested with the site. I'm more interested in the site collection properties. So I'll click on this gear icon that you see on the extreme right, and I'll click on site settings. When I click on site settings, you'll see a lot of properties or a lot of settings that are related to the site. However, I'm more interested in the site collection administration. So within the site collection administration, I have something called as site policies. So I'll go ahead and click on site policies, and you already see some site policies created over here. So what these policies are is every time a user creates a SharePoint site, you want the user to define what is the criteria of the SharePoint site, because you don't want to be in a situation where users are creating sites left, right, center, and ultimately you've got these tons and tons of SharePoint site that was just created once, looked at once, but never looked at again. So by creating these policies, you're actually setting timelines, as in you're setting the closure time period, you're setting the deletion time period on all these SharePoint sites that are created. So it is putting more control as to whenever an end user creates a site mailbox, he or she needs to define how long will he be using the site mailbox. And you can control, you know, whether it can be a year, it can be 5 years, it can be 10 years, or it can be just a month. So by creating these policies, you are enforcing or you're controlling, or it's like a housekeeping of the number of websites or number of SharePoint sites that are created within your SharePoint form. So let's go ahead and create one so it becomes a little more clearer. So I'll just give it any name. So I'll call it the Ignite Webcast. And here you can see, you can see the site closure and deletion properties. And within the site closure and deletion properties, you can see a few of the radio buttons. And let me just click one which has got a little more properties to play with. So I have selected that delete the site automatically. And let me just give it a description. Delete this site after 5 months. Let us say it's not really critical. This one is for 5 months only, okay? And I go ahead, and then I've got these criteria. I've got some notification, you know, how quick or how far enough I want a notification telling me that, you know, this site would be deleted, and then I can state that how this site needs to be closed, okay? That's it. These are the criteria that I choose or I've chosen in this particular policy, and I'll go ahead and hit OK. So right now it will go ahead and create this policy. It is nothing but like a template which has some rules within it, and over here, we can see the new Ignite webcast that has been created. So this, the description is, it would be any website that has been created with this policy will be deleted in 5 months. And I'll show you how it looks like. Another setting that the admin has to do per se is, if he needs to enforce this, you know, just by creating a policy, you know, like how we have mailbox policies, we've got Outlook web access policies in Exchange. Similarly, you need to enforce that. You know, as long as you don't enforce a policy, it would not take effect. So similarly, in SharePoint, you need to either enforce this policy so that end users are forced to choose a particular policy. And that you do by clicking on the settings at the very bottom within the SharePoint admin center. When you click on settings, there is something called as start a site. When you click on start a site, at the very there is a small drop down over here which talks about site classification. So here are three options: hidden from user, so that means a user would just creates a site, you know, he's not forced to choose a policy. If there is an optional choice or a required choice, so I would say set it as a required choice, and I would go ahead and hit OK. So now once this is done, let me go ahead and create a new site. So now let us say I'm an end user. Now I say, okay, fine, I'm going to create this new site. And I'm going to create, call this site mailbox. And let us see the new policy that we see there. So you see here the new policy that we created. So I know that this is related to Ignite, and I don't want it to last for more than 5 months, all the content within the site. So I'll select Ignite Webcast, and the description that I mentioned is over here. And once I click on Create, that is it. The SharePoint site with that particular policy has been created. Now, since I have this particular SharePoint site, I can now go ahead and create a site mailbox for this. And I go ahead, and the same process that I showed you earlier, I go ahead, click on Add, and now I click on the mailbox. So by doing this step, because I have enforced a policy on the SharePoint site, it automatically applies the policy to its associated site mailbox. So right now, this particular website that I've created called the Ignite site mailbox, because it would be deleted in 5 months, the site mailbox that is being created right now would also be deleted after 5 months. So that is how you control a site mailbox. You know, the life cycle of a site mailbox is controlled in that particular manner. Okay, so that's simple, very straightforward how you manage site mailboxes. So let's go back to our demo, to our slide deck, and let's continue at where we left off. Enabling site mailboxes and SharePoint within SharePoint and Exchange. This is primarily for the on-prem users, and critical only for the on-prem users, because everything with regards to Office 365 in the backend has been done. So all the, because Exchange and SharePoint are two different products, for the two different products to be able to talk to each other, there has to be some mechanism that needs to be set up. So all that has already been done. But for on-prem, as an Exchange admin or as a SharePoint admin, you need to perform some steps. And the most important prerequisite is, of course, you need to have SharePoint Server 2013, and you need to have Exchange 2013. And very critical with regards to Exchange is you have to have your auto-discover working properly. Okay, if that doesn't work, then, you know, as I showed you earlier, auto-discover is the transport layer that this kind of shows or highlights or tells Outlook as to what site mailboxes you're a member of. One more thing to keep in mind is regarding the mapping of SharePoint with Exchange. You can have a single SharePoint form or multiple SharePoint forms pointing to one Exchange forest. And the SharePoint form has to point to an Exchange 2013 server. It cannot point to an Exchange 2010 server. So a very, very important criteria for this whole site mailbox to work, your SharePoint form has to be pointed to an Exchange 2013 server. Okay. And just to make all this very easy, you know, for an on-prem admin, there is a script available. It's a provisioning script. If you go on TechNet and you just search for site mailboxes, it's actually two PowerShell scripts, but they kind of run within each other, so you can think of it as one big script. When you run that script, it automatically goes and checks for all the prerequisites, and then it will also set up the integration between SharePoint and Exchange, because there has to be a few things that need to be set up, and, you know, it's your OAuth, which is your server-to-server authentication, has to be set up, partner applications have to be created. You have to make sure web services are installed, because that's web services used, between Exchange and SharePoint, and that's the mechanism that it uses, that each other use. So all this has to be checked. And that particular site will actually go ahead, that particular script will actually go ahead and check for all these prerequisites. And if all the prerequisites are in place, it will then go ahead and set up the integration. So it does both. It checks for prerequisites, and if all prerequisites are in place, it will actually go ahead and set up this integration. So if you're an on-prem user or a customer, feel free, go ahead and run that particular script. It's very useful, and I've used that in my for my labs, et cetera, and it runs smoothly. One more piece that is critical within a site mailbox. So a site mailbox. So you've got the site bit where it's connected to the SharePoint, and you've got the mailbox bit, you know, which is within the Exchange mailbox itself. So there are some or a few aspects that you can control for that particular mailbox, which is a part of the site mailbox. And a few things are the prefix and the mailbox quota, because it is a mailbox ultimately, because the site mailbox is provisioned with an Exchange, it is a mailbox ultimately. So you can actually control what is the mailbox quota. You can also control the prefix, and that is all used, controlled using the site mailbox provisioning policy. That's a global policy, so it applies to all site mailboxes that are created within your tenant or within your on-prem organization. So I've just got small snapshots of what it looks like. So when you run the get site mailbox provisioning policy, so this field that I've highlighted in red, that is for your mailbox quota. You can see the max receive size, which is 36 MB. You can drop it down if you like, if you don't want the user sending such large emails. And you can see the probability send and receive quota, which is capped at 5 GB in size. And if my memory serves right, shared mailboxes have a quota of 5 GB. So, you know, a site mailbox is also considered, a collaboration and a sharing kind of a mailbox. So it's also capped at 5 GB in size. The other one is with regards to the prefix. So the one in the red box you can see, that is where you would kind of mention what is the prefix you would like for your organization. And in white, you know, within the white box, that is nothing but a snapshot of my auto discover. You can see the prefix that has been added to a site mailbox. So this site mailbox display name is ZT1000 launch. And by default, in the cloud, that is in Office 365, all mailboxes have a prefix of SMO. If you're doing it on-prem, you would have a prefix of SM. You know, you don't have the O. O stands for online, so site mailbox online. So if you don't like SMO, as I mentioned earlier, go ahead, you know, change this policy and put a prefix, let us say ABC, and then every time you create a site mailbox, then it would be updated. It would have a prefix of ABC dash, you know, whatever.com. Okay, so this is what you can control a little bit from the mailbox side, if you have to say so. Diagnostics and troubleshooting. So let us just look at the end user's experience with regards to diagnostics and troubleshooting. So for that, again, I'll jump back to my primary screen so that you can all have a look at what I'm going to do now. So I am going to open up my Outlook client. I'm just going to probably just minimize it a little bit, and I'll just escape from this session. Okay, so I've got Outlook open there, and let me just open up. So I've got a file with all documents over there. I will click on version 2.2, and I've got a few documents lying around over here. Okay, and let's simulate I'm going to upload a document. Okay, so I can upload it directly from within my mailbox, or let us say on my desktop I've got a document and I'm just going to upload it. Okay. Let us pick the one that is pretty small, and I've got something called as case studies. Okay, I'm just going to drag and drop it over here, and it would fail because you see there is already one called case studies, and I'm uploading another file by the same name called case studies. So technically it should fail because SharePoint wouldn't allow you, because all this upload is happening to SharePoint, not Exchange. So SharePoint already has the file name of case studies.xlsx, so it would say, okay, I see another file, I'm not going to accept it, and then it's going to screen. And so we'll see how exactly it looks like. So on the screen right away you can see nothing really happened, but if I go ahead at the very bottom, these three dots over there, and if I change it to a folder view, in the folder view within the sync issues for that particular site mailbox, if I click on sync issues, I can see it tells me upload failed, and then I can read in a little more detail the error message. And it clearly states that a file with the name shared document blah 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 already exists. And that's what I kind of simulated. I already uploaded a file that had a similar name. If it was something else, it would give you a little more descriptive information, saying that it failed because of so-and-so reason. And this is how you can actually look at it. Now, because it is somewhere within the sync issues, you know, it is something that the end user wouldn't realize. You know, he might think that, you know, he has already uploaded it. So in this case, Alice thinks that, yeah, she's uploaded the document and she forgot to see the sync folder, you know, because the sync folder in the normal view is not visible. However, because Alice tried to upload it and it failed, she also gets an email in the inbox. So whichever user tried to upload that document, it would send an email, you know, the failed notification to the mailbox as well, to the actual mailbox rather than the site mailbox. It will send it to your original mailbox. So it was exactly the same that you saw within your sync, you know, sync folder for that particular site mailbox. And this is how the, you know, the end user can look at it. You know, if it's very straightforward, like this in this example, it is this, it's a similar name, so I can just rename it and upload it. But if it's really very, you know, not very understandable for the end user, he or she can just forward it to the admin and then the admin can work on it later. Okay, so this is, you know, what has been inbuilt so that it is more, great experience so that the admin or the end user can understand if ever there's a failure while uploading documents while he's working on these documents within the SharePoint site or within, to be more specific, within the site mailbox. One more thing that the site or the user, the end user can control is, because as I said, the SharePoint site, if you need to see or you need to get access to a site mailbox, you have to be a member or you need to be the owner of the SharePoint site. Other than that, let us say you have uploaded a document or someone has saying that, okay, I uploaded the documents directly onto the SharePoint site, but I'm seeing within my Outlook client, I don't really see it. So there are different ways of actually controlling it, or you can actually see why that has failed. So if I right click on my site mailbox, which is, you know, here product design, and I can click on site mailbox properties. And that will, you know, connect up and it will open up a web interface and it opens up the properties of the site mailbox by the name of product design. And this is actually the ECP, you know, because it's a mailbox. And if I just zoom in, if you look at the URL very closely, it is /ECP. So it is the properties of the site mailbox. And within the site mailbox, you can see the name, you can see the actual email address, and you can see the SharePoint site it is associated with. If you click on the users, you can see the actual owner, you can see the members. You know, let us say I've just added a member and I don't see it here, and it's obvious that, you know, the user won't see it until it reflects over here. And the last is a very useful option, which is the start sync. And the sync is of three, when you click on the sync button, three things are synchronized. The first is the document itself is synchronized. The next is your membership, you know, the membership that you saw over here. And the last is, you know, any type of maintenance job, like how in Exchange we have like a, you know, like a maintenance job that happens, your background scanning, sorry, that happens at night, you know, not in the new versions though, but something like a maintenance job that runs within SharePoint. So these three tasks are called when you hit on start sync. And if you can just look at my sync, it happened at around on this date at around 3:50. And it's 6 o'clock for me over here where I am right now. So it's been a while, and if I think, okay, the user has updated and it's not syncing, I can just go in and hit start sync. And the other option is email me the details. And if I've hit, you know, sync many a times and I'm still not seeing updated information, I can click on email me the details, and that details actually contains the synchronization information. You know, whether it failed to sync, whether it failed for a reason because it was not able to synchronize a particular document, for example, or whether it failed because it could not talk to the SharePoint site. The SharePoint site is down, so it could not retrieve the membership information. So all that information is collated, and then it would be sent to the user. So in this case, it would be Alice. So it would come to Alice, and then Alice can actually forward it across to the admin and then tell them that, can you actually look at it? And the admin can also do it himself, but it, you know, if the end user wants to do it and it's particular to his particular site mailbox, because the admin wouldn't know, you know, which site mailbox you are actually working on, you can actually click on email me the details and then forward it on to the admin. So these are the end user diagnostics that are available for a particular site mailbox. Just moving on a little bit quicker now, because I see the time. We're actually going a little bit over time again. So if I click on end user diagnostics, so that's exactly the same thing that I talked about. You get an NDR about the failed upload, then you can manage it within Outlook itself. You can force a synchronization, or you can actually have an email sent with the sync status. And with regards to the admin has a lot of PowerShell commandlets that are inbuilt, and this is within the Exchange itself. So you don't have to, you know, import the SharePoint module or anything. Within the Exchange module, you have all these PowerShell commandlets, like the test site mailbox commandlet. You have the update site mailbox commandlet. And at the very bottom, you can see an example where I have where you can actually change the URL that's associated with the site mailbox. So these are some of the tools that are available. All of this work by default in an on-prem environment. For Office 365, some of the switches would not work for obvious reasons, because they don't because we don't want you to test it against, you know, some unknown website or some unknown SharePoint site. So most of them are available. Some switches would not work, but you can experiment it for yourself, and I'll leave that for you. So just collating everything that we spoke about and that we talked about, from the creation to the deletion to the life policies, and the thing that I have been hammering about, that how you need to, the way to manage site mailboxes is only through the SharePoint site. So let's again just put that all into perspective and just quickly run through what we have to do from the end user's perspective with regards to Outlook. So when you're talking about Outlook, site mailboxes are only visible or they light up if you have your mailbox on Exchange Server 2013 and if he or she is using Outlook 2013. It is not available in Outlook 2010 or anything below. It has to be Outlook 2013 Pro Plus, and that's the only version in which site mailbox would kind of get lit up. Okay. Next is, if you want users to access their site mailboxes or to have visibility of their site mailboxes in Outlook, you have to give them permissions either as a member or as owners for that corresponding SharePoint site. And lastly, the maximum number of site mailboxes that can that are highlighted within Outlook is 10. If you want more than 10, then as I showed you earlier, you can obviously pin it and unpin it using the, you can go and manage site mailbox option. If we come to the server side, what types of documents are synced in SharePoint? So all containers or all lists in SharePoint that are of the type document library are synchronized. When I talk about synchronized, it's the metadata. So all that data is synchronized in Exchange, and you have to keep in mind that that particular document library also has to be in the quick launch. So it is both of these criteria have to be fulfilled so that Exchange can show it within Outlook. It can show you both the document library and the site mailbox within Outlook. Secondly, within SharePoint, you have these special type of libraries called asset libraries. Asset libraries are slightly intelligent kind of SharePoint document libraries, wherein, let us say, you have you can segregate. Let us say you create a SharePoint site and you create asset libraries for music, for movies, and I, as an end user, I open up the SharePoint site and I upload a music file, an MP3 file. It uploads to SharePoint, but in the background, it kind of moves it to a folder that's dedicated for music files. And similarly, if I upload a movie file, it would get uploaded to the SharePoint site, but in the background, it's actually moving it to a folder that's specific for movie files. So if you're actually doing this within Outlook and you're actually doing it with, you're dragging and dropping a file, Exchange sees the upload happening, but then in the background, because SharePoint moves it to this dedicated folder, it thinks it has failed. So that is something to be mindful of. Though Exchange sees it as a failure, in the background, the actual upload would have succeeded. Okay. And another thing, a few other additional things or things that you can perform on a SharePoint site is you can request that every time a user uploads a file to SharePoint site, that he needs to put in some additional metadata. You can do check-in, check-out, versioning. You can do co-authoring. So let's take an example of check-in and check-out. So if you're using Outlook and you actually upload a document, and that particular document library within SharePoint is enabled for check-in and check-out. So when you're uploading the document in Outlook, it is actually it is set as a checked-out document within the SharePoint site. So what you will have to do is then you will have to go to SharePoint, which is easy, right-click within Outlook and go to the SharePoint site and check it in. So these SharePoint document libraries, which have these special features, for them, you will have to perform a little bit of additional tasks because Exchange doesn't understand these additional features. It doesn't understand check-in, check-outs. It doesn't understand versioning, etc. So for these additional features that you've turned on within the document library in SharePoint, you will have to perform an additional step. But if you have a default document library, nothing. Exchange just sees it as an upload that's happening, and it uploads it to SharePoint. That's all. And lastly, talking about we know Outlook can work in offline. That's what cached mode is for. So if I'm working, if I'm traveling in a train or a plane, or if I'm, you know, I don't have internet access, I can open email and I can start working on it. So let us say in the same example, I open up Alice's mailbox and I'm looking at the site mailboxes and I see these documents. However, as I mentioned, when you click on the document, it's actually going and calling the actual SharePoint, you know, the document which is on the SharePoint site. So this would, you know, not be a great experience because I can work on all my emails because it is an offline mode, but I can't work with the documents per se. So in those situations, what you can do is you can actually create an offline copy of all the SharePoint documents. And that's a very straightforward method of doing it. So if I'll just quickly jump to my, you know, to my primary monitor just to show you, it's just a single click. And within a single click, and if I go back to any site over here, so just to show you, right on the top, you know, within the properties of the SharePoint site, there is a button called Sync. And as you can read it, when you click on the Sync button, it would create a offline copy. So let's say I'm on the train and I'm working on all my emails, and then I see, okay, let me work on some of the documents. I go ahead, click on the document. When I click on the document, it actually goes ahead and looks for this offline copy, and then all those edits, changes, deletes, everything happen on that particular offline copy. And when I come back to the office, or I connect, or I'm online now, that I'm connected, what will happen that the sync would complete because it would sync from your offline copy, which is on your laptop or your desktop, and then synchronize to the actual file, which is residing on the SharePoint site. So this is an easy way wherein you have the great experience of working with emails, which is there in your inbox, and you have the experience of working with all the documents which are there within your site mailboxes as well. Okay, and again, one more flip. I think that's the last flip for today. And okay, so this is the last slide. I won't go in very great detail. I'll leave this for you. You can obviously look at the you know, the slides will be available for you. These are just showing you all the triggers as to when the synchronization happened. So for example, on the top right, the one that I'll just talk about right now because I'm on the slide, is if your Outlook is open and you're working continuously, the synchronization is in the background. It is every 15 minutes. So if you haven't uploaded, if you're uploading a document, the sync happens right away. But if you're not uploading a document, or let's say some edits are happening in the background into that document, it is synchronized, or that metadata is synchronized every 15 minutes. Okay. So everything, wherever you see a D and an M, D stands for document documents, and M stands for membership, because I said the synchronization has different sections. So when you do a sync, you're actually synchronizing a document, you're synchronizing a membership, and there is one more type of synchronization, which is actually a maintenance cycle, and that also runs when you click on sync. Okay. So that brings me to the end of the site mailboxes. So I'll open this up for questions. I know I'm running slightly above the 1 hour limit. I'll leave it to Josh to open it now.
Yeah, thanks, Rup. Great presentation.